Gifted Interview, Season 2.
We're at the TV Land Comic Con Suite with a significant representation of the Gifted cast, here to talk about Season 2. Welcome, everybody.
Thank you.
So I understand there's a big time jump and Polaris is ready to pop.
Oh yes, real pregnant. Nine months to be exact.
Super pregnant.
Yes, the baby is born.
I'm picturing a nice, quiet water birth, very zen.
Yeah,
maybe
really,
some spa music in
the
background.
Yeah, real calm. No, she tears apart the city. and it's really heartbreaking because the father is not there for the birth or the naming of the child or any parental decision that is made. It's horrible and heartbreaking.
Marcos.
I know, I'm a bad dad.
Did he try?
Bet your bottom dollar he tried. Okay.
Okay.
Well, I try as hard as you did to save the underground last year, buddy.
I like this repetitive
going
theme.
Everyone tries, and obviously the Struckers are trying with their own child in mind, Andy, who's gone off with Lorna, but yeah, I mean, he's hell-bent on that exact thing, is finding his daughter, and he feels not only has his love been taken away, and that's something at some point he might have to stomach and get to get grips with, but the child is something that's just awful.
I mean, he doesn't even know it's a girl.
Doesn't know it's a girl or a boy, he doesn't know anything.
As Season 2 opens up, what kind of reputation did the mutants have after the whole airplane explosion incident?
I'm great. I'm a bigot killer. Wait, not me, Blair.
Not good.
Not good? Worse than ever?
No, they exist in a more hostile world outlook towards mutants because of that.
Yep.
And also, Thunderbird's general failings mean the Mutant Underground aren't thought of too impressive.
Well, let's just keep circling back to it.
What did go down? Why did it go so badly for you?
Well,
it started when this family showed up. It's really weird.
And then it was just downhill from there.
We're doing pretty good till then.
Yeah. I mean, facts.
Probably were surviving for years. Flourishing, you might say.
Wait, no, it was Blink.
Flourishing might be like
awesome.
Yeah, flourishing in a hovel.
And then I got arrested. Yeah.
It's true. Kind of when Blink showed up, that's when things kind of went sideways.
Also, the Struckers felt like you should see the country.
Yeah. Right?
You're missing so much in the
beginning of last season, they were living their best lives.
And then,
that's how bad
with every person that showed up, it just got more and more and more complicated and disruptive.
If season one was about the Strucker family kind of finding their place within the mutant world, what would you say the theme of season two is about?
The mutant
the
world itself.
Family finding itself within the mutant.
The mutant world itself, I guess, and its divisions and its.
Well, I think that we sort of leave the story with the idea that there are these two separate factions.
Mm-hmm.
When we come back 6 months later, we start realizing that there are other factions within the outer world as well, and
okay.
So we meet the Morlocks, which are literally living underground.
Mm-hmm.
And then we establish some of us do, a relationship with the Purifiers,
okay.
Which is the sort of militant hate group. And so we sort of start seeing how other factions of the mutant community have been able to live and get by without having to sort of meet or coexist.
I also think the idea of family sort of shifts around too, because it's not just about, you know, who your, you know, husband or wife, but it's also like ideology as a family and like how that can sort of bind and divide groups of people. And I think like that's evident with how Andy doesn't identify with what his family believes in anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And he sort of gets inducted into the Hellfire family. But then I think you watch even the Frost sisters like start to disagree with each other, or how Lorna and Marcos are a family, but like the ideologies are split, and so people are sort of forming new families based on what they believe in, which makes for some juicy conflict.
And also, I think one of the things that is interesting is personal truth.
Yes.
And personal belief of, and it doesn't mean that the love for the family of origin has
both are true.
Has
the
dissipated.
Love is real.
It just means that the burning passion is the one that one follows. Whether it's
one's
right
existence.
Or wrong.
Yeah.
Are Reed and Caitlin going to power up in any way? I've heard things about a sword, that maybe Amy Acker is working with a sword this season.
Really?
You know a lot. What's going on?
Who told you that?
Well, not the sword thing, but everything else was on point.
We left Reed realizing that he had things taken away from him when he was a child. And so he is certainly looking into what that means, and they're trying to do everything that they can to get to Percy's character, Andy, back. And so that has led him to maybe try some things.
Okay, I can work with that. Jamie, with the time jump, has Blink mastered the whole portal thing? Are we still glitching out? Is it still kind of iffy?
She's at ease with her power, I think, but the interesting conflict with her is, you know, she meets the Morlocks and she has an interesting secret, but she's kind of torn because she's very comfortable with where she is now with her relationship with Thunderbird and like getting on, but I think a wrench is thrown into things when she meets the Morlocks. So it's like, what is the right way to live? What is a better community? Like, what works for her? And mm-hmm. you know, she's always on the run and she's settled down, but I feel like there is the interest of possibly leaving again.
And something really interesting that I love about actually all the couples in the show, I think it's interesting that Thunderbird so easily passes as human, whereas Blink cannot and never will be able to. You know, and even within the Starker family, there's always one person more than the other that has these things, and I think that builds sort of underlying resentment towards your partner and your, you know.
I think also we're also delving deeper into the when we talk about the burning truth, the inherent sort of mode that one wants to function by. You start to see that, like the secret that Jamie has, that you'll, you know, find out about, I think, and will show why she acts the way that she does. We delve into people's backgrounds, mm-hmm. their histories with that. Like, we go to Colombia and you meet Marcus's family and why Marcus is the way that he is. We sort of
is focusing in on individual traits, mm-hmm. and everybody will get the audience will get to see how the evolution of this story, mm-hmm. and also, you know, we're touching very much on themes which are inherent today, and which has always been tradition's the wrong word, but it's certainly been part of the X-Men mythology. And
it
we
does
continue
hold
to do
the otherness
special
of people.
Now.
Yeah, yeah. For Skylar and Emma, you got one half of the Strucker twins. Are you kind of gonna be cruising the other one and trying to get her into the fold?
Well, I mean, for our characters, last season we weren't allowed to say it, but we are the descendants from the Von Strucker twins. Mm-hmm. They're obviously extremely dark. And at the end of last season you see us kind of disintegrate the entire underground, so going into this season, she kind of feels a resentment towards her brother because she can do this really awful
Didn't
thing.
Did I say resentment mm-hmm. earlier?
And she has, I mean, I think that inside of Lauren, she has a darkness that she's really trying to fight. And there's a part of this group that she gravitates towards.
They can help you out with that.
We can do all the bad things you like.
We're going to take Lauren. She can be a triplet. Like, we'll just have like this little blonde posse of villainous women.
I mean, the truth is that we're trying to scrape together all the most powerful mutants, and their family. Is mutant royalty. My family is mutant royalty. Hell, we'll take the daughter, the father. We'll take them all.
Oh, jeez. We got three of you. You have Grace Byers as a new kind of Hellfire figure.
Awesome. Love her. Mm-hmm.
Are they going to get along, though? Or is there kind of a power struggle there amongst the ladies?
Do any of us get along?
Well, I think what's interesting is when we meet Grace, Grace's character this season, I think the Hellfire Club is very elusive and sort of unknown in season one. We feel their presence, but we're not exactly sure what their purpose is. And we open the season with a very sort of bold foray into this world. Yeah. And I think the agenda-driven strategy at hand, like, you really get to see, like, we realize that Grace was sort of involved all along. We didn't know her season one, but we sort of connect back to things that might not have been totally clear season one, sort of come to light. And, like, you know, they say the devil's in the details, and we really get into the details with the Hellfire Club this year.
Okay.
So I think you'll learn a lot more about, you know, who the Frosts are, where they came from.
Are we going to differentiate the three Frosts at all?
Is
one of them more flirty than the other two?
They're all flirty.
Phoebe has a wandering eye for sure. We do. The girls are very different. There's maybe more sisters to come, which is exciting. And I also think that we get to see them alone for the first time, and so we get to explore the inner dynamic.
Yeah.
Marcos could do with that because he hated you from day one, and then he found out there were three of you, and he just the anger went through.
It's fun though. It's fun when they argue amongst themselves. Mm. It's a bit of a headache, but I'm figuring it out. Yeah, it's fun.
You figured it out and you've mastered it. I would say
it's hard to cut yourself off in an argument. It's like, you shouldn't, but no, you should. It's very like. It's
she
a little awkward,
but
God bless our editors who make that seem like it makes sense. So.
And then lastly, Blair, give us a taste what sort of new mutant powers we might see during the season.
New
characters.
New mutants?
Yeah.
I mean, I can't give away anything specific. We have some good people coming in, but I like some of the Morlocks. I mean, just just based on what we were talking about earlier alone, they're a tribe of people that have banded together and they
sound like
physical
they need
attributes.
A
it is a dirt, they do,
yeah, they live in the sewers.
World.
It's pretty gross.
They live in feces.
But physically, it's just such a cool group to me because our makeup team gets to do so much special effects and.
And our costume
there's
designer.
Also an interesting. Isn't there an interesting? I haven't, been dealing with them as much, but there's an interesting sort of mindset and idealism, isn't there, about the Morlocks?
Yeah. Well, that's what separates them from the underground. They want to exist by themselves. They don't want any part of the upper world, as it were. We want to coexist.
Yeah.
We're trying to find a way to do that. They're just done with humans. They're done with Homo sapiens.
It's interesting. We have these. Oh, sorry. We have these four groups, and you can rank them sort of on a spectrum of what their beliefs are. But when it comes to certain beliefs, they can skew and go into different spots.
Absolutely.
So they want to live underground and by themselves, and that's something another group wants to do. Where you would think of them to be as more closely related to the mutant underground, but in some aspects, not at all. Mm. If that makes any sense. It doesn't.
It does.
Watch the season. You'll see. You'll all see.